When Jesus Christ was suspended between the twilights of two worlds, we had to have some elements there, and to save man. And blood and water were the two elements that came out of the side of Jesus. When the soldier pierced him in the side, these elements were there, and they came out of his side. And then the blood that was shed for the remission of the sins of the world, it came out of his side. And all of that showing us what it is or what's necessary to cleanse us from our sin. That blood's essential. And the water that came up with his side is essential. And he can't be washed without water. And he can't get to the cleansing power unless he learns where it is. Well, if I stand here and tell you that the blood's in the water, I speak correctly. That blood and water came out of his side. But when a soldier pierced him in the side, there's your two elements. And then when that blood is shed on, when it was, it is shed, Jesus dying for the world, and not only that, that same blood bought the church. Therefore, we just understand that, he said, God, the elders feed the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. The blood that was shed on Calvary was even the blood that bought the church, and the church was paid for. Now, the only way to reach this cleansing power, like you women here and speaking on television, why, they tell you, get your washing machine. And then they tell you, then get your water. And then they tell you to go get Dash. Dash, well, what is Dash? Dash is the cleansing power. You can put Dash in the washing machine, and you can put it in there and let it stay there all day. You never get your clothes clean. You're going to have to get you some water. And the water and Dash. The water and the blood that cleanses from every sin. Now, this young man labored extensively tonight to show you that baptism is essential to salvation. Jesus Christ even begged to be baptized. He didn't only have to be told to be baptized, or he didn't wait to be told. He went to the preacher and begged to be baptized. If the people understood correctly tonight, they'd be in Nashville all around now begging to be baptized if they had never been baptized. You would be come down here now and beg Brother Peeble to baptize you tonight. If you understood the Bible, you wouldn't want to go home out of Christ. But you'll have to come to Christ through the water. The children of Israel had to cross the Red Sea, or they couldn't go to the land of Canaan. And in the act of crossing the Red Sea, the enemy was slain. And the enemy of man today is his sin. And when you cross through the waters of baptism, every sin is destroyed. The Egyptians were destroyed. They followed up there and followed God's people right to the river, to the Red Sea. And when they got there, they were handicapped, walled on both sides, mountains rather as they come up to the Red Sea, surrounded. But then there they stood, didn't know what to do. But Moses says this, and I think this is advice we ought to give all people. If you don't know what to do, stand still. Don't go jumping down in a molder's bench and roll all night. Stand still till you learn what to do. Why, do you not know they stood there and waited on Moses? Then God spoke, and Moses stretched the rod out over the sea. And while the rod was hanging over the sea, the divine hand of God and the power of God parted the Red Sea. And then Moses commanded them to march, and they marched across. And even God, to prove that he had the power, dried the bottom. He dried the bottom, and they marched through the Red Sea on dry land. And sometimes, in order to make my point clear about this water, they walked across there on dry land. And not only that, the power of God was demonstrated, never have been read nowhere, have never read nowhere, where the bottom of the Red Sea was dry. I might say dusty, and hadn't been dusty since, because God didn't want it that way no more. If he wanted that way today, he could do it. I just believe that strong. But when he marched, told him to march across after the waters congealed on both sides, and Webster says the word congealed means ice. And everybody believes Webster. You can't get nobody, they dispute the Bible, but not Webster. They tell you Webster's right. Webster's right. Webster. Not Paul is right. Webster's right. Paul said baptism washes your sins away. Why don't you say he's right? No, it's Webster. Well, Webster is right in his field. He said, right, I'll take him in his field. But when it comes down to religion, it's God. God is right. His word is right, and every word of it is right, and we know it's right. Now then, they stood at the Red Sea, and the water that hole was made. Did you know them children of Israel had to have a lot of faith to go through that? They didn't see nothing hole in the water. But me or you and I would have said, now how are you going to make it through that? As far as it is through yonder, they don't see nothing hole in that. Faith led them through that. By faith they crossed the Red Sea. Faith leads us down into water baptism today. If you haven't got the faith, you're not going in there. And without that faith, you can't be saved. Without faith, impossible to be saved. So we have to have faith. You've got to go down in the water of two or three things I'd like to call your attention to. You must have this kind of faith. Go down in the water of baptism, believing that Christ is down there. Believing the blood's down there. Not only that, you've got to believe that it cleanses you from every sin. You've got to believe that. And when you go down with that proper faith, you come out with the thing accomplished that God said that was for. For what? Remission of sin. This young man that's preached in front of me tonight, if he just keeps on, brother, and tracking that thing like he did, nobody can meet him. Nobody can dispute it successfully. And he'll take care of the church you're after, Brother Keeble, and all of us here are sleeping beneath his sod. He'll be able to do that. Just keep him growing, grow, and the church will be more and more proud of him. Sometimes I wonder, are we sleeping on this thing you call education? Have we gone to sleep or what? Somebody says, well, what the matter with them old-time preachers? They didn't go to school. Well, yeah, I know they didn't go to school, but somebody had hold to them that had been to school. So you ain't to go to school, but somebody had him. I can tell the very minute a man's been properly taught. Jesus said, go teach. Go teach who? All nations. And after you've taught them and that get them to understand it, baptize them. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And when these children crossed across on the Red Sea and got on the other side, then what did they do? They stood right there and noticed the enemy destroyed with water. I want to use that little word, with, is important. That little word, it destroyed with water. And then when I lead a man down in the baptism and bury him in the name of Jesus Christ, Father, remission of sins, I'm looking on a man that's being baptized, translated out of the kingdom of Satan into the kingdom of God's dear Son. That all happens. In that transaction, that all happens. And we're born to water. Did you know man is the only thing that God created that has to be born twice? Right, he's the only thing that God created. It has to be born twice. If a man's saved, he'll have to be born twice. Born into the world and then born into the kingdom of God. He's going to have to be born if he's saved. Well, what has he got to do? You've got to bury him. And in the bury with Christ, into Christ, by baptism, we rise to walk in the newness of life. We've taken the pains that we take because an audience like this is always somebody in it that wants a little more information on baptism. I never go into audience. Over in Memphis, not long ago, there was an old gentleman came in there just before we left him down there, and he wanted to know, would he have to be baptized again? Well, I told him, scripturally, you've never been baptized. You just got wet. Well, I said, I'm baptized. I said, no, I doubt you've ever been baptized. And then I could go over, he got to school, about one baptism, one Lord. Then I went over and about and showed him why some people got two baptisms in one. And yeah, that stopped him. He said he hadn't thought about that, but that's our trouble now. I know, there was the two baptisms. Did you know that when John's baptism, some people at Ephesus, I believe it was, and Paul came up to him and he questioned them about their baptism. Under whose baptism were you baptized? He questioned them. And that thing is important now. People who say they've been baptized, they need to be questioned about it. Well, what about your first baptism? Well, a whole lot has to do with whether you believed it when you was doing it. Do you understand it? When you go down in the water baptism, anything you do for God, get a good understanding. All of that getting, get a good understanding. And there the children of Israel was, they were baptized in the cloud and in the sea. They were covered up as they crossed over. And the Egyptians pursuing after them, what became of them, destroyed, never heard of anymore. And the sins that we commit when we go down in the waters of baptism and come up, they'll never be maintained anymore. They are gone. Just like the Egyptians were destroyed in the Red Sea, also we go down to water baptism and all of our sins are destroyed and will never come up against us anymore. Washed away in water baptism. And not only that, the man who goes down into water baptism with the proper understanding, he comes back another man. I'm not afraid to say that. He went down one man and came back another one. All done almost in the twinkling of an eye. God's going to do something else in the twinkling of an eye. All of us that are remaining on this earth, when Jesus comes back, we'll have to do something with us to get us off of the earth. Ain't no time for burial. He's just going to change us. No burying or nothing. And the twinkling of eyes all over. That's all. That's all. And you know we ought to be getting ready for that final day because he might come while we're still walking around in that. Well, you've got to be changed because no flesh and blood can go up there. Ain't no flesh and blood going to hell. You're going there, that flesh was an evil spirit going down, good one going up. That's what we're, and you're going to have to get into Christ in order to die without having to, without being changed and the twinkling of an eye. And I want to say to you again, and the children of Israel stood there on the other side of the Jordan or the Red Sea and saw their enemy destroyed. Destroyed with water. God done that's a nice water job, isn't it? Well, surely he can wash your sins away if he can destroy a whole nation. Take water and destroy a whole nation of people. And if he can do that, he can take water and wash my sins away. Was a man once a drunkard, habitual drunkard. Had a family. He was mean to his family, as a lot of men are. Abusive, get drunk and come home, stomping around, running over everybody, and everybody skipping like you're scared to death. A lot of men want that. Somebody who's scared, somebody jumping. Then he thinks he's the head of the family. But did you not know? This man went to the meeting and was baptized. His wife left him and took all the children and went home. Told her papa she stopped, tired staying at home being beat up. And the husband comes home drunk and he said, just come right on in. And any good father will try to take his child and provide for it when they have a husband like that. And here she is at the door and he's been beaten on her. She's come to get rid of that beating and that cruel treatment. Did you know that pretty soon he comes and knocks on the door and his father-in-law steps up to the door and says, you just get on away from me. You beat on her enough. He said, Papa, I've never hit her in my life. Well, I know you have. I've seen you beating on her. I've come up when you was beating on her. I know you have. No, sir, I never did hit her. I said, I was baptized in a meeting up there last night, obeyed the gospel, and I'm another man. I never hit her. Is that good? Well, if that ain't straight, then you tell me how he was telling the truth. He said, I've never hit her. The old man was driving him out of the yard. Get on out. Get on. You are. She's not going back to Texas Street. Said, I ain't never hit her. Why, she said, you used to curse her. No, I never did curse her. I ain't never cursed her. I sound like he's lying, nobody telling the truth. He's got a good understanding that what he did up at the church and he's baptized and sins are washed away and he's coming to his wife, another man. Another man. A brand new man, made over, regenerated in an heir of God in a joint heir of Jesus Christ. Born again and regenerated. If that ain't changing a man around, it takes God to do that. That's what we call, I think, in some of the languages, a new birth. Born again, a new birth. Every man needs another one. I don't care how old he is, if he's never had it, he needs another one. That's plain enough. And Nicodemus came to Jesus' word when Jesus talked to him about this new birth. He had a misconception. Why, he asked one of the most foolish questions that was ever asked by any human being. Can I go back and be born to my mother? You understand? A ruler of the Jews come up with a, he looked like he ought to have better sense than that. But when you're ignorant, you're just ignorant. Is that right? Jesus said, I am not talking about your mother. You got the wrong conception. Nicodemus, I'm talking about your mother. I'm talking about a water baptism. I'm talking about buried with Christ in baptism, born of water and of the Spirit. And you, I'm not discussing your mother. Anyone know, could he go back and be born of his mother? Silly as he could be. A ruler, and that's the men the silly right today, them smart ones. Been to college and had his brains expanded. Why, he thinks he knows everything. He's a doctor, he's a reverend, he's a DD and a double LD. Too much, ain't he, brother? He's just too much to have good sense. And Nicodemus came up there, no sense at all, asked a cynic question. A little child ought to know better than that. But when you don't know, you just don't know. Jesus said you have to be born of water and of the Spirit. Or you cannot even not only go to heaven, you can't see it. I'm going to see that you don't see it. Plain as it can be. And that same teaching that he did to Nicodemus is the same teaching we need tonight. I don't care who you are. I was preaching in Detroit once, and the boy was waking for very well for late, and he was attending the meeting, and he went back to work the next morning after he was there, and he told the white lady when he's serving breakfast, he said, I wish y'all could hear Brother Keeble, a preacher from Nashville preaching. And the lady said, well, can it could I hear him? She said, yes, and said, he's preaching over the radio in the morning, and I'd like to go in, and I don't have a radio. Would you let me come? She said, yes, you could just, when it comes on, you just come. There's somebody good white people in the world. Just call him from the garage, said, your preacher's on. Your preacher's on. Well, the boy come out of the garage and run in there and sit down. And had never sit down in the living room before, but she had him in there listening. He's in the living room sitting down listening. And she says, is that the preacher that you say, yes, sir? And then he said he looked up and she was peeping through the door listening at it. And you know, so the next night she went over to the meeting. She wanted some more out of it. Everybody wants it. If they ever hear it as plain as it is, you crave for it. Simple and plain, nothing plainer. You can't keep her but her understanding it. And she told him the next morning, I enjoyed your preacher. I enjoyed your preacher. But I learned later on from the brother that said she was baptized at the White Church of Christ several years after that. It stayed with her. This thing, you can't get rid of it. If you ever understand it, you can't rest. I'm trying to preach now so you can go home and can't rest tonight. I hope you can't do nothing but roll and tumble. That's right. And when an individual is out of Christ, he's in a dangerous state, ain't he, brother? If you don't roll and tumble, you ought to roll. Or you're going to roll and tumble in hell. Why would you rather roll that? Get right. Get right. Get yourself right. Don't look at me. I got nothing to do. I'm trying to stay out of that place. That's the reason I was baptized in water. I was buried with Christ in baptism. And I rose to walk a new life. I'm trying to walk new every day. I'm not going back into those old things. If I do, I'll be lost and go to hell and have to be rolling down there. I don't want that. If there's one in this audience tonight that's willing to give up his sins and break down that wall that keeps you separated from God, only in baptism can that wall be broken down. I read in the Bible where the children of Israel commanded to march around the walls of Jericho. Once each day. Once each day. And on the seventh day, march around seven times. They look like fools. To the people marching around walls expecting them to fall, they do look weird, don't they? But they was doing it by faith. They were doing it by faith. Ain't nothing foolish when you do it by faith. You look foolish going into the water to be baptized. Not if you have the faith. Would I have the faith? There's an old lady baptized in Murray, Kentucky. I baptized, and she was loved by all the people. They were called her mother. And everybody admired and thought she was a Christian. But when I came in that preacher, she was about 75 or 80 years old. And somebody told her that some of them she was going to be baptized. She said, why, Auntie, the white people she worked for said, you already a Christian. Ain't nobody better than you in town. You're just a good person. Well, there's a good person in the 10th chapter of Acts, wasn't it, brother? You look for good men. We're not looking for good men. We're looking for Christians. These people in the Baptist church isn't as good as I ever will be. Give their arm, they give more to the Lord than I do. They wear better clothes than I do, but he ain't born again. would have to be born again. You may, brother, when you get the right conception of this, you'll roll all night. You'll run right on into water. Be glad to do it. I was baptized much not long ago, and a man before I could take his confession, he didn't make it to the church. He was running out there in the water, and I liked to baptize him before he made his confession. I couldn't tell him from the others. He was in the gang. Got a man run down the water with the rest of them, somebody hollered, he ain't never confessed. I took his confession out there in the water. You got to make it. You got to confess Christ. I don't care where you are. Standing out there fixing to have my hand up somebody hollered, you ain't never took his confession. Hand went down. He's got to confess. Is that right? Got to confess. Except you confess me, I will not confess you before my Father and the angels of heaven. Confession is that fourth step, is it, brother? And you got to take these steps in order. You can't run one round in front of the other one. May God speed the day when the Bible be rightly divided and everybody can understand it. It's so simple and plain, it makes you wonder, why don't they understand it? And this old lady I was fixing to tell you about when I baptized her, she went back in the trunk and got a dress she'd been stowed away to be buried in. And she stowed it away in the trunk, a satin, white satin dress. And somebody told her, some of the white ladies where she went, went down to help dress her. They thought so much of her. She's out there in the bushes, and they carried her way back out there in the bushes and dressed her. She comes out with a white satin dress. White satin dress, and they got around and said, don't go in this muddy water and ruin this pretty dress. I said, no, but I couldn't understand what so much commotion just because her dress was too good to go in with. She said, I know what I'm doing. I married my first husband with this dress on, and now I'm fixing to marry a greater man than him. Do she understand what she's doing? She's not a crank, is she? A lot of us are cranks, but she wasn't a crank. She said, I'm going to marry another man greater than my husband. I've got it, and I put it away. I didn't know I was going to have to do this, but since I've learned the gospel, this is greater than when I married him. Fixing to be married to Christ. When we obey the gospel, the church is Christ's wife. And when you rise out of the water, Christ's water saves you so you can go into him and washes you clean. So you can go in that clean and sins washed away. And like now, like all of y'all are 10 years old. You can't understand this. You'll make it. And if a heart can't understand this, you don't need to worry about nothing. You'll make it. But ain't nobody in here that ain't. Nobody in here understands this. You may never do it, but you understand. And I'm sorry that people are turning down till Jesus comes back. I'm satisfied. He didn't tell you to be satisfied. You got to do the thing that satisfied Jesus. And if you ever quiet up to court and your lawyer's pleading your case, he's got to produce proof there that'll satisfy the judge and the jury. Not you. It'll satisfy you to turn you loose. That is satisfaction. You're not after satisfaction. You go before Jesus Christ. May God speed the day when men and women will submit to the gospel of Christ and surrender. Will you do that tonight? I've talked enough to you. This young man talked enough. You was ready when he sat down if you was paying any attention to him. And now here I come adding some more and endorsing it, showing it up. You can't help but endorse it. It's right. You read it. You're rightly divided. You understand it. Are you here tonight? Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will, just anybody, he doesn't pick him. It isn't drunk. You obey the gospel of the Son of God and the baptism of your way. You lay out every sin. You deny yourself. As I sometimes say, men are so bad about running after women and chasing women that are not their wives. I said, sometimes when you obey the gospel and tell you ain't coming down here no more. On you, man, don't look for me no more. You robbed my children, you took bread out of their mouth, and I'm not coming down here no more. And then that's what she needs. A lot of women in town just sit and wait for a man to get paid off. Man, he got a bit of sense. Preach him the gospel, learn him some sense, and he'll stay at home. He'll live righteous, he'll be an example to everybody he comes in contact with. Are you here tonight and willing to surrender? Will the baptism and be regenerated?